Well, first of all, thanks for bringing me over here from New York and San Francisco, where I spend most of my time these days. I don't get the chance to do keynotes in this kind of a manner. People aren't usually arranged in tables when I do, and many, very, very few of them wear suits. And so I understand that situation, and I do. It's not completely foreign to me. So I'm going to go forward with this. I'm going to first give you some info on me, just in case you're the kind of person who says, okay, well, whatever he's saying, I'll figure it out later. I became known many years ago because I made a site called textfiles.com, which was a collection of bulletin board system era text files that I had collected in my youth and that I had kept the floppies for. And in 1998, nobody seemed to have them up. So I put up tens of thousands of them, and I suddenly became known as the guy you give your old crap to. And it's nice to be kind of that halfway house in between the trash bin and it never leaving your attic. And for some people, I'm the way out. I'm the first step on the 12-step program, which is give Jason all of your things, and then 12-step is stop collecting things. But I've been doing this for a number of years, and what happens is that I'm a loudmouth, and I'm very, very unwilling to look around and say, well, nobody's done this, so I guess it shouldn't be done. And as a result, it's put me in some bizarre positions, which is what Jeffrey's talking about. The way that we first met, or the way that he first brought me around, was because I was a preeminent Wikipedia critic, which in today's era is like basically being against candy. Right? I mean, I actually stopped calling myself a Wikipedia critic because I would talk to college students who are now 18, and the only question they would have at the end is, why are you criticizing Wikipedia? And you realize that for all of their adult life, there has been nothing but Wikipedia as a centralized source. It's just there. And so criticizing it, they don't even have the context from which. So anyway, I'm not a Wikipedia critic anymore, even though I have problems with it. All right. And so when I talk to people who are outside of my area, I know that people come to a presentation like this because either this kind of a situation where I'm plugged in, or because the description was kind of weird. And so I'll say, you know, what I hope I bring to you is something where you hear a little bit of this bizarre little activist who speaks in this weird way, and that you come out of it thinking, well, except for the parts where he was totally wrong, I did like this one little part, and that was kind of cool. And that's perfectly fine with me. I live mostly as an idea these days. I tell people about where I'm coming from and what matters to me, and then from that a few people get good ideas and other people get really, really bad ideas. Now, people have various things that they absolutely love, like this is a man's well-loved Bible, where he insisted on looking up everything and cross-referencing it, and I figured that was appropriate for this crowd. I found this on an image board, for a lot of people, just the love of the interaction of information and what it matters to them is everything. Similarly, I like to collect bizarre bits of history that just don't quite make sense. This is a Christmas ad for a Colt rifle called Wouldn't You Like to Give Yourself a Christmas Gift? Somehow they had meetings and this happened. It's real. They really did put that in magazines. It was time to give yourself. Again, this is a beautiful ad for DDT infused children's wallpaper, which I guarantee will ensure that the insects are not going to hurt your child, right? All put together with all the beauty and the strain and the wonder of pop culture advertising designed to make you feel that this is something that's good for you, right? And it's interesting that because it's actually a harbinger of potential cancer and death, it actually gives you kind of just enough separation to look at the look at the advertisement now from a completely new point of view, because at the end of the day, the product's going to kill you. Similarly, you have an ad for asbestos, which itself has problems, telling you, isn't it great that the World Trade Center is full of asbestos, because if it ever goes on fire, it'll take 2 hours to evacuate. This ad has completely different context in the present day. It's got about five or six different major things when you look at it, where you're just like, wow. They weren't even thinking of it that way. Again, here's a beautiful, beautiful photograph. Two models taking pictures of each other. This is actually Afghanistan. And this is that same photo taken a number of years later. And at the time, it's just, you know, this image of Afghanistan as being, you know, here we're doing some modeling, just as you might do it in Paris. And what you have here is taking that old stuff that was sitting around, giving it new context, and then going back and referencing that gives you something much greater than the two photographs. Now, there's something actually putting all these together, which is that all of these represent material that didn't go away because a long lineage of people did nothing. They didn't try to update their back archives and throw out old photos. They didn't shove things into a for sale sign and get rid of it. They didn't give it to the wrong group. They just said, okay, well, we have this and we keep it around. And it's that inaction that ensured its persistence. A lot of preservationists talk about the activity of preservation, and I will talk about that too, but there's some inaction too. There's that refusal to sit around and say, well, this seems to have no contemporary value, I'm going to get rid of it. And that it leads to a bunch of things living on much longer and perhaps finding brand new meaning in today's world. This, for instance, was an interesting preservation project I was part of. There was an Apple II game called The Prince of Persia that sold very well for itself and then got licensed into an even more greater set of sales for modern computers and ultimately was made into a movie, which is how most people know of it now, is that Jake Gyllenhaal Prince of Persia movie. And the original creator of Prince of Persia, Jordan Mechner, had lost the original source code. He ended up actually not knowing where the disk was, and he had harassed tons of people, the people he had worked with, his family, like, where's this disk? I know I kept it, and it was gone. And then one day his father was moving out of his apartment and sent him a box of old junk, and in it was the disks. Now he has a problem. It's 2012. He's got a bunch of 3.5-inch floppy disks. What does he do with it? And this is what we did with it. I asked a buddy named Tony. Because that's how you get a lot of things done in America, is you get a guy named Tony. And this guy named Tony happened to have a large variety of old Apple II equipment, which we set up, and we were able to pull all of the source code out. And then Jordan, in what I consider to be an extremely generous thing, let us post it on GitHub, which was a open source sharing site. And people have gone through it, and there have been people who have major pedigrees in gaming history who have gone through the code now and given commentary and said, wow, I didn't know this could be done, and what did this mean? And he's gone on to give talks that way. You know, something along each of these, you know, might bring something of interest to you, but in this particular case, you're seeing a large amount of effort for something that is merely 16 years old, right? This is an extraction operation to bring in a bunch of equipment to assemble. We had Wired magazine there to overlook it as if it was some sort of Al Capone's vault thing to pull out the source code to a video game from just a mere 16 years ago. You know, we lived in a world where we used to be able to sit around for decades for something to, we could figure it out. You know, we'll get around to it. And you open up the archives. Relatively recently in America, there was this book that had been sitting around in the archives of a town called Beverly, Massachusetts. And what it was it was a logbook of witch burnings. And what it was Beverly used to be Salem. I don't know how many people. Salem got a little tired of being the witch burning place, so they renamed themselves to Beverly. And then you say, but there's still a Salem. Some people wanted to be the witch burning place. I'll debate that later. But the thing was that this book existed for hundreds of years, and it was in a filing cabinet of a town hall. And the thing was that we could sit around for a couple hundred years and get around to it. We're well out of that way when it comes to electronic information. Another example of sideways stuff. This is a publicity photograph trying to show the two actors on the left. What it really is, of course, for us now is a complete how-to in how movies were shot in the 30s. It's all of the equipment. It's where they had to put the positioning. You can see this massive, normally I have a laser pointer, but if you look to the side of their heads and you look at that massive apparatus, that's the microphone for the talkie. So that's why they had to be so careful about how they set it all up, and they've got padding on everything to make sure that you can't hear this terrible, massive machine blaring through and recording film. And we are well to the point that we're not going to have this knowledge anymore, because the cameras are almost, you know, the size of your fingernail, and we're going to end up getting this being used to reference time that has passed on. So I'm a part of a team called Archive Team. This is why I was brought in. And to describe, I don't know how many people here have heard of Archive Team before this exact second. All right, one person. That means I should explain it. It's just one of those off the cuff calculations. I'm going to go with probably tell the people who've never heard of it what it is. So here's what we are. We are an activist preservation group, a hybrid that should not exist on Earth, but we are. We're an actual group of young people, primarily, with some people assisting us from various groups, who are going in and preserving websites and online materials, in some cases offline materials, with no heed to the rules of society about asking permission. Now, to give you an idea, if that sounds aggressive, this is our actual logo. And what we are is, we're finding ourselves in a situation where people have websites that are going down, and these websites are going down at an increasing clip with a bunch of things related to, social media, related to come store your stuff with us, where we currently have no legislation, no rules, no anything aimed towards what about the end? Like, it's real easy to buy the puppy, somewhat easy to keep track of the puppy, but nobody has any contingency for the end of the puppy, and it's always messy. And there's a lot of puppies ending, right? We have a lot of websites that grew up in the late 90s and even the mid 2000s, and even now we're finding ones that are going up a year before speculatively, saying, please give me copies of your data, and then announcing, and believe me, I have experienced a wide range of this amount. Hey, positive name for all of you. We are, euphemism for quitting, in X amount of days. And so you have X amount of days to remove your whatever it is. And that part is optional, because sometimes they don't say that. Thanks. And I've now seen that amount go anywhere from 1 year, which was Apple's MobileMe, to 72 hours, where they will take your data for a couple years and then say, well, next Tuesday we're going down. Or yesterday, technically there was one -5. And that was really good. That was a good one. That was a good day. But what we're finding is that people were told computers were an awesome place to store things, and that they were an awesome place to keep their memories. And as time went on and we integrated, and we turned it so that you would literally go from the memory of a person into this box, and then something would happen, to finding out that where it went was somewhere completely random, with no guarantee of long-term preservation, no export function, and certainly no tools to help you get your own materials back. Now, when I talk to people who are more established or whose full-time job involves the manipulation of data or information or storing of stuff, sometimes this can read as an anti-technology screed, and I mean that by no means. By no means. I adore the modern world. For a person who spends all of his time doing things like making documentaries about computer technology of the 80s. I can assure you that the technology of the 80s was quite inadequate for producing any sort of a documentary like I do now. And my ability to just look down on my phone and know what the weather is, and the ability to like share an idea, the fact that even today while I was sitting here over in my table, I was able to take a photo of you all and put it up and talk about how awesome you looked. I was able to do that because a whole bunch of technology exists. But I also know that when I take that picture, it's going to a very random image sharing service that a group at Twitter decided was going to win the photo sharing lottery, and that they use a URL shortener, which itself is the single worst idea in technology in the past 10 years, and then link a bunch of people randomly to it. And it's incumbent upon me, if I decide that the photo I took has any sort of long-term meaning, to go in and grab all of that and push it in and put it somewhere for a longer term. Because that whole the whole segment of, wow, it's up for the internet, has been, that's where the story ends for technology companies. And the whole, well, what happens in 5 years, not so talked about. So Archive Team spends a lot of time at that end game. We're currently involved in 3 or 4 projects right now. We've been around since about 2009, and we are astoundingly aggressive. One of our major tools is something called the Archive Team Warrior. The Archive Team Warrior is a computer program that sits on your machine. It puts something up called a virtual machine. So basically a program runs on your computer that acts like another computer inside. And in it, it's got all these pre-made, beautiful tools that require very little human intervention to work. So if you ever experienced something called SETI at home, which is where you could use your computer to look up extraterrestrial signals to see if they had any sort of a meaning in them, it's the same idea. It's Archive at home. And what it is we will give you a menu. And on the menu, it says, here's what we're working on. For instance, here we're working on something called City of Heroes, a collection of forum postings for a game called City of Heroes. And that's just ended about a month ago, where City of Heroes, the company that owns it, NCSoft, said basically, we're done, and we are going to close everything in 60 days. We're going to erase all of your forum messages. We're going to remove all of your files, all of your characters. We're going to delete it all. To which the audience of City of Heroes said, why? To which they said nothing. To which they said, please, could you keep it up? To which they've said nothing. So we went in and took it and put it away, and it turns out to be a couple hundred gigabytes of messages, which should tell you how much effort and work went into this thing over the years, that we have 200 gigabytes of text messages. And so we have this system here that was going through and allowing dozens of people to download the thing and create an archive. We have a thing down there at CS that says Archive Team's Choice, which means, you know, you can just leave it running. In fact, when it's running, it just looks like this. In the upper right, it's telling you how long before the project is done. And then here are two windows that are grabbing them and putting them into WARC format. I do speak some archiver language. So the web archive format, because we were told that was the most permanent version. Too bad almost nothing uses it. So we found out that WARC was this format that everyone needs to talk about in their archivist moon language. We went and found the most utilized web grabbing software, which is wget, and we put an agent in there, and he spent 1 month and he put WARC in wget, and as of 2 months ago, it's part of the standard issue of wget. Is WARC is done by a random crazy grad student somewhere in Norway, because a bunch of other crazy people all around in Archive Team said, well, if that's what it takes to get this done, we'll get it done. So it uses this version in there. Now, obviously, if you're dealing with a bunch of young people, you need to have a leaderboard. Whoop, do I not have that here? Oh, I don't have the leaderboard there. We have a leaderboard. I probably put it elsewhere in the thing, so that people can actually get achievements, and they can achieve who's doing the most downloading. And you'd be surprised how much that gets people involved. So what happens nowadays with an Archive Team project is that we hear about something closing, like here, Yahoo Briefcase. You are completely excused if you have no idea what Yahoo Briefcase was. Completely excused. Yahoo Briefcase was this astoundingly generous service that Yahoo created in 1997 that allowed you to have up to 10 megabytes of free FTP storage to use on the road. And it continued up through to 2009, to which the natural answer is, why did you shut it off? Why did you keep this for 10 years And by the way, it never changed. Up to March 30th, 2009, you could store 10 megabytes for free at Yahoo. And they announced that they were closing it. They gave them 1 month, 30 days, after storing their data there for 10 years, and said, okay, bye. We get a lot of that, a lot of bye. Now, we couldn't obviously go here. These were all private FTP accounts. There's no way to really reach them. So ostensibly, nobody had anything important there. BT Internet just deleted, we think, tens of thousands of user accounts off of their web service because they had an older service that was from the late 90s. They gave them all 30 days after 10 years, emailed them ostensibly at email addresses they don't check anymore, and let them know that their old websites are going to go away. We get a bunch of these things. This is goodbye from Encarta. You get things from like again, farewell. We're closing it. Thanks. Please visit us elsewhere. And then you have things like this, where you have these promises, lots of promises. Office Live Workplace offers to back up your files now. And yet, there's really nothing you're signing to indicate when you're going to be able to keep it, when they might delete it. And there's now too many examples where you can't say, well, they'll do the right thing. Because in the modern contemporary era, there is no right thing. So this just exists. I love this one. Obviously, somebody who's part of an activist preservationist group would be fascinated by the fact that now MoviePhone and Fandango have a deal where they have a bunch of ads for, remember storing those old concert tickets and those old ticket stubs? Remember those awesome memories? Well, now you can do that again online. So they have a service where you actually go to see a movie, and then it keeps it in something called AMC Stubs, and you can keep your ticket to share with your friends. For free, I guess. One part scrapbook and one part time machine. It's all this language indicating longevity. I don't think this is going to make it past 2015. I don't think so. I would love to make a long now bet over, like, can I go look at my ticket stubs in 2020 on the AMC stubs? There probably won't be an AMC in 2015, much less a stubs program. And yet this language continues to go on. We're sharing memories, store your things forever, keep it with us, store it in the cloud. I'm not a big fan of the cloud. I'm a big fan of the idea of the cloud. I'm a big fan of the idea of an always persistent storage that exists in the world, that you can always be happy, will keep your stuff as long as you want. I also like unicorns. But the thing is, you know, one way to get around that, by the way, linguistically, is I've told people, instead of using cloud, which is a weird malfeasance of the original history anyway, try clown. It's about the same thing. So I'm storing my files with the clown, I put all my finances in the clown, I have a clown-based service, and works out a lot better, doesn't it? And it makes you think for like maybe that 1 second before someone just drops that on you and says, no, it's cool, we got it in the cloud. Because we've had cloud outages, and that's when everybody discovers where we're all linked. And the thing is that language is being used without anything to back it up. You know, if we look at history, it was a big deal to get things right. And unfortunately, you know, in the rush to put things online, there's a few ethics and a few approaches that we've kind of lost. Here's a 1997 GeoCities page, and you are completely excused for not being able to read it because of the bucking bronco background. This is from a site called GeoCities, which enabled you from 1994 onward to store your website on with them. Now, bear in mind, you know, in 1996 is when it starts to become prominent, and that's a time when to print a color page on a printer will cost you $1.25 down at the printer. So the fact that you could have this full color, maybe with music, website, that lets you talk about your life as the rogue cowboy, and you really can't see it, but there's a little gold badge right next to his picture, and it says that he's a member of the HTML Writers Guild. So, another thing we've lost by the wayside. This was rescued from a site called GeoCities, as I said, which announced that they were closing in a roughly 4 months. And the way that they did it was that it was, the way they announced they were shutting down, by the way, was in one of their frequently asked questions. One of the questions was, why can't I use this particular feature? And it says, oh, because of the impending shutdown, that feature has been decommissioned, which is really burying the lead. And we found out, yes, they were shutting it down, and it was completely random when they were going to shut it down. And then eventually it became late October, and then it became mid-October, and then it became October 24th. And there were millions of accounts on GeoCities. Millions of accounts. You know, accounts like Dee's Parrot page, where you have the first time that people, folk art, people are just bringing their lives online, like a really interesting time in history that people are faced with this publishing. I mean, remember at the time, this is amazing. You can produce all of this publishing quality material in full color and write, and theoretically the entire world can look at it. More people than in your entire genetic line combined may interact with your web page potentially. That's an amazing power. And what do people do with it? Well, yeah, the Bunking Bronco and Dee's Parrot page. But then we found this thing, which was about Patrick Joel Melky, who was born on April 16th, 1981, and then entered heaven August 17th, 1983. And this woman has page after page about her son, her two-year-old son, who died. And, you know, it's not until you really think about it that the page is from 1997, and you realize that this woman encountered GeoCities, and her first thought was, I have to talk about my infant son who died nearly two decades ago. This is what I have to share with the world. And this is one of the things that they just wiped out. Now, obviously, since we're looking at it, somebody grabbed a copy, and that copy was Archive Teams. It turned out there were two other groups who also were running through because we perceived that maybe this wasn't a good idea to get rid of it. So, I don't want to cut, you know, one of the things about activists is that activists are extremely tiring, right? Like, if you got an activist who's like, you know, oh man, the gold standard, we have to go back on the gold standard. It's amazing. You try to talk to the person about anything else, and somehow the gold standard wanders into it. And I believe that, you know, preservation is an important thing, and I think that Archive Team's motives are very good. That is to say, we try to get in that moment when a service that people didn't know they were depending on is shutting down, and we grab a copy to provide for later. There was a site called Tableau, T-A-B-B-L-O. It was bought by HP. HP also bought a company called Snapfish. HP left Snapfish and Tableau in a room with a broken pool cue, and Snapfish emerged bloodily, leaving Tableau to die. Tableau shut down, and this is when we found out we were able to download all of Tableau in about 36 hours. Wasn't a lot of people using it. Maybe only about 70,000 people were using it. What we found out was they were all moms. And almost all their photos were of their children. Because the way they'd marketed it, the way they'd marketed Tableau, it really appealed to young mothers who were at home with cell phones. And you can imagine what all these mothers were like when they went to Tableau, not really using that old email address, and everything is gone. Their entire child's early days are gone. And we were able to set up an immediate rescue provision where you could type in your username and get your photos back. Only your public photos. We didn't have any access to your private photos. You know, we're not hackers, we're just very eager. And so we provided for these people photos of their children. And so, you know, people were like, well, how do you get paid? And I'm like, that's our payment, right? We get paid by the fact that we watch these long letters from these people who are like, without you, I would have lost my child's entire childhood. And, you know, geeks will say, well, you should have kept backups. And I'm like, that's like walking up to a car accident and saying, I would have worn my seatbelt. Like, you're not helping. You think you're helping? You're not helping. This is the most positive image I can find on the internet. This is a wizard driving a Trans Am in space. Anyway, that's all I got for the internet's positivity. I got, okay, so there's my brother, and behind him is my shipping container. And this is where all the stuff that those people send me had to go. I took a photo of it at one point recently, and it looked like this, which was nice, you know, considering it's completely full of floppy disks and computer equipment and everything else. So a couple people had written to me and said, Jason, you know, you really should do something about that. You should, you know. And I was like, great, dude, give me money. Like, I'm really busy right now. I don't have time to install all the stuff. And people are like, just do a Kickstarter, man. So I did a Kickstarter. And in the Kickstarter, I said, okay, 7-day Kickstarter. All you people think I need to, like, clean this thing up. Great. Let me hire some people. Let me put up some shelves and other things. Give me $2,000. And 7 days later, I had $6,000. 152 people dropped money just on principle to say, this material that you have should get the best treatment. And it's gotten really good treatment. I mean, make no mistake. And a lot of it is slated to go to other archives, which it always has been. So it's, you know, I think of myself as a way station because it's very hard to convince archives to go after computer history. I was interviewed by People magazine about my cat in a story I'll tell you over dinner or cocktails. But I have a very popular cat on Twitter, which apparently is very critical to the news organizations to report on. She asked me what my occupation was, and I said, oh, computer historian. And a couple days later, you know, they take photos of the cat, everyone's happy, cat doesn't care. And she calls me and says, my editor won't take computer historian. I'm like, what, don't take? She's like, she won't list that as your occupation. Would historian be okay? And I said, okay, given those two choices, yes, historian. And so People magazine was absolutely unprepared to accept computer historian in 2011 as a legitimate occupation you would want to put in a public magazine, right? Now, computers, obviously, you know, you can go back 50, 100 years, you can do a whole bunch of things, but it's still too new. And so I'm finding that I am just this little tiny stopgap, a little way station. I'm not the end station. But just stuff's kind of important. It's extremely very ephemeral. And then by the time people get around to it, it's going to be gone. Now, people are starting to get around to it. There are some wonderful archives I've been interacting with. The Strong Museum of Play in Rochester, New York. Stanford has some beautiful archives. I got the. I was shown a piece of paper talking about these two jokers who want free printing for their flyer, and the joker's address is on the back, and it's Steve Jobs, you know, from 1976. People are like saving old material, but it's still, we're still in this weird, weird little quirk of history, which is, it's not being accepted fast enough, and yet the material itself is dying. This is something I was involved in. The Internet Underground Music Archive was started in 1993. It was an attempt to provide people with a way to put their music online. To give an idea of how long ago it is, they have WAV files, they have MP3, MP2, and AIFF files, because it's not clear which one's going to win. So the bands are releasing songs in AIFF form, in AU. And it grew until 1999. It got bought out. The group that bought it out did nothing with it for 5 years, and it went down. So then it turned out that John Gilmore of the Electronic Frontier Foundation had made a tape backup of his grab of the music, and we put it all back up again. So we put up 42,000 bands worth of music. Of that, 15 have told us to take it down again. 15. 15 of them, usually, it's always a good one though. It'll always be like, oh, you gotta take the dirty splotches down, and it'll be from like the director of finance of some major company. You gotta take that, and I'm like, oh, the bassist is not happy. But on the whole, we've gotten all these people who, it was their first performances, it was in many cases their first band, and they've gone on to other lives, but we were able to save it because of one person. So one of the interesting things about online world and online things is that even though it's so easy to delete, it's also so easy to save. Just all it takes is a little bit of effort and a little change in goals. On the right is a 5 1/4 inch floppy disk. On the left is a machine called a CryoFlux. So what a CryoFlux does is it connects to the back of this and allows it to read any 5 1/4 inch disk format, up to and including a magnetic read. Costs $69. Somebody sat around, fabricated this thing, and it exists. Similarly, this looks like a screenshot from a very old computer. It's not. It's a team of people who have been working to write software to emulate CRT monitors, because they're all going to go away. And how are you going to explain to kids what a CRT monitor was and why their stuff doesn't work? Because we're discovering that the old software was written in a way that assumed that it was going to be a beam hitting a piece of glass and that there would be just enough fuzziness. Now, you're like, again, wow, Jason, really random. But what I'm trying to show here is that these are very young people who recognize the value of history and the value of preservation, the value of keeping things around, and the value of making efforts to store things even when the exact reason that it was useful won't be known for decades or lifetimes. And sometimes when I deal with people who are involved in archives or involved in a lot of old material, they say, well, now kids don't care anymore. And I can positively tell you that not only do they care, but they absolutely love it. Not all of them, but I got some 17-year-old kids who just can't believe that we used to bring up programs on cassette tapes, trying to explain a 17-minute load time, sounding like it's like the Jews being driven from Egypt. It's just this painful process that they cannot believe that we endured in our youth. So I'm just very excited about the fact that in doing this preservation activism, I encounter so many young people who really get it. You know, when Gaddafi was deposed, somebody on our team thought to himself, I'll bet his website's not going to stay up for very long. So he went over and he grabbed a full copy of the full, hey, I'm Muammar Gaddafi website. And I mean, it's a real, and the reason you'll even know about it is because he grabbed the copy. And he grabbed all, they were producing films about how awesome he was and putting them out in 5 different languages, and they were putting out all sorts of other material. And he grabbed a copy of it. And a week later, rebels told that ISP, take it down or we'll kill you. Which is a very, very effective shutdown notice, by the way. And so we have it. We've put it up, we've given it to archive.org for their Wayback Machine to ensure, because while some people maybe want to have it that he never existed, it'd probably be a good idea to understand at least somewhat of what Gaddafi thought he was to try to get it by. They do the same thing with newspapers. I'll get these people who are like, I went off and I made this connection with this group and they have all these old papers and I'm going to see that the old papers get saved. Is that good? I'm like, yes, that's very good. You know, they've learned that there's virtue in respecting the past and saving it. So what does this mean to you? So I give people pretty basic instructions, because it's like, you know, you don't go to a keynote, you don't sit through a keynote to be told what to do. But you know, the number one question that I get, or the number one question I give to people, is where is the export function? Where is the export function? Because that's the number one thing that totally gets ignored when a new site goes up, when a new project goes up. I've been working on a little weird little project on the side called Just Solve the Problem Month. I'll quickly explain what this idea is. Every year there's something called National Novel Writing Month, which says you've always wanted to write a novel. November 1st through 30th, you're going to write your novel. It is going to be awful. I mean, it is going to stink to high heaven because you're just going to write out 50,000 words. And it's got tools so that you can see how you're doing per day, and you can share with your friends how many you've written. And at the end, you end up with a novel. Maybe you're never going to touch it again. Maybe you're going to delete it. But there's actually been cases of these novels going on to be published and actually get contracts and everything because a person finally achieved the dream. I like that idea. I like that idea a lot. So I came up with the idea of maybe we should have a month where everyone gets together of a certain stripe and just solves a problem or just goes after a problem. Just a month, some dull month. And so I proposed for the first one something called the Just Solve the File Format Problem Month. Because I talked to a lot of archivists, and it appears that a lot of them have this idea that, well, there's 1,000, there's 10,000, there's 100,000 file formats going back in history, and we're never going to enumerate them all, and we're screwed. And I'm like, well, what would happen if a few hundred people focused on just enumerating all the formats as fast as possible? We're now 17 days in on it, and we've done thousands. And it's been very exciting to watch not just people get involved, but to kind of run into the way people look at the world. I've got people from the Library of Congress, people from different archiving groups, and sometimes just folks, and they all have the same kind of, like, it's funny because I think that they feel that they're the rebels in their organization, and I interact with them, and they're the organization in this project. Like they've been so enmeshed in it that there's things that are just there. And when you have something like this, the simple question, where is the export function? It belies an entire set of beliefs that are not compatible with quickly rising projects. Because the last thing any project wants to talk about is how to leave it. The last thing. And yet that's going to become the most important question of all over time. It'll be, okay, now we have version 2.0. How do we move to it? And if the answer is we can't, then we end up in our current world where people are actually still running Internet Explorer 6. And even Microsoft has begged people not to run Internet Explorer 6. Like, you are now causing damage to the world by running Internet Explorer 6. You are risking yourself. We can no longer fix all the holes in it. Your system will become a honeypot. It's dangerous to run this. And people are like, oh, well, steady as she goes. Let's keep going. I hit this site and it comes up. We're done. And similarly, the idea of, well, we're here. What are we worried about? We'll just keep it forever. I feel like that need to transfer it on to the next thing is just a value that perhaps is not as obvious. And I'd like to see it used more. Or this guy's coming for you. I took this shot as a promotional. There was a site called Friendster. It was a social group, social media. It's actually one of the first social media, like real social media. Log in, share it with your buddies, websites. And they announced that they were deleting, it was 120 million accounts. 120 million. We only got 25 million because their system started to collapse under the weight of people actually. It was like a bank run. It was like actually trying to retrieve it. But one of the funny parts was you had to get an account to be able to download the accounts. So we did that, and this was the profile photo we had. It was, what are your hobbies? Downloading Friendster. Anyway, I hope that I've given some insight into what I'm up to, and I'm not leaving. I'm actually here. I'm staying here. I'm gonna live here, I think. And I'm more than willing to talk about what I've brought up here because I think that's just basically what my function is. Now, like I said, for some of you, you're gonna walk away from this and be like, well, that was dumb. Some of you are gonna walk away and go, I like a lot of what he does except for the stuff I hate. And some people are like, I have a new purpose in life. And I think that there's some real benefit to just hearing from a person who talks like this. Not all day. It gets a little dull in our RSC channel. We got some kids in there. They love talking this all day. But if nothing else, if you come away from it, and if there's one thing you come away from, it's just thinking about the fact that there's no sin in a lack of permanence. it's not a bad thing that things move on. And just asking your people and asking your processes to say, what happens in 10 years? Not as a method to slow the project down. Not as a method to make it that you stay intractably stuck in your current working paradigm, but as a way of thinking about the end, because the end becomes someone else's new beginning, then these last 40 minutes have been well spent. So thank you very much. If anybody has a question, you know, it's funny, I've seen that this has now happened 3 times where the person comes up and like shoves the other person up. Oh, did you have a question for that person? But if anyone has any question or comment or fear or concern or threat, I like threats. Threats are good. All right, I guess not. Oh, come use the magic microphone of doom.
Craig Van Dyke. Maybe I missed it, but can you say something about the business model?
Absolutely charitable. Absolutely down the tubes. We lose money every single time a disk drive flips. Absolutely. There is no situation where archive team is a business model. Archive team is a stopgap methodology. Now, if you're talking about the larger, wide extent of this, I think that there's great monetary value in indicating that you have given thought to the persistence of the efforts utilizing your system. That if you say, we're not locked in. Like the days when you could lock something in, about the only time that the only current market I think that is truly, truly locked in right now is space station interfaces. Like right now, there's only like 1 or 2 people you can really talk to about getting your space station interface. And I think that's going to end soon. So I don't think of it, I think that there's an actual business case for showing that you know, people overuse the word open, but certainly to show that you have not, that you're not going to waste people's time in the future. But oh, no, certainly. The first time someone comes up to me and says, well, what about the business case? I'm not even gonna joke with you. No. You go out to a guy who's sitting out in Occupy and you go like, dude, how are you gonna earn money with this? He's not gonna earn money with that. Your question, sir.
A comment, actually.
Okay, those are good too.
Evan Owens, American Institute of Physics. I am a historian by education and have spent 7 years in the digital preservation space. And I want to congratulate you for the work you're doing. It's incredibly important. I worked in the formal digital preservation space, and what worried me the most was the lack of attention to the informal preservation of the rest of the world. And this is wonderful stuff. In my historical research, which was 18th century London, actually, I used an enormous amount of materials that were collected by 19th century historians in scrapbooks, materials that libraries didn't collect, but amateurs collected and put them together into scrapbooks, which then they gave to libraries to join the historical heritage. And which is what I see what you're doing. This is fantastic.
Yeah.
Because there's amazing, we all know there's amazing resources out there that are not part of the formal process. I mean, there's websites by amateur historians that I worry about what's going to happen to when those people are gone.
Right.
And I hope you'll be there. So well, thank you.
Well, thank you. Well, it starts out with like, I've had formal training and I've been doing this formally. It usually doesn't end well, but I'm glad to hear it. Because sometimes people look at something that we're doing and they're like saying, so what you're saying is you want to get rid of us. And I'm like, no, the opposite. I'm trying to increase the amount of work you and your descendants will have from all this other stuff that's been collected and will be oriented towards. But the thing is, the value systems are impossible to determine right now with web-based data. You know, we downloaded all of MobileMe, and I don't recommend that. It was 274 terabytes of data. Don't do that. And the thing is that, you know, we store with a couple of organizations, we store this data, and there was a lot of like, really, 274 terabytes? Do you really need it? And I'm like, well, that's you. in 1995 going, 400 megabytes, do we really need to keep this? And I think, you know, I've been amazed actually to watch, you know, it's now to the point that people are able to, like, we just had a breakthrough in emulation in the last couple of days. Somebody is now streaming a Macintosh running System 6 over the internet so that you can try the software in a functioning emulator that's elsewhere. And I've been working on a project like that too. And all of those things will need historical data to work from. Similarly, I put up something called, it's at textfiles.com/underconstruction. And if you go there, there are thousands of under construction animated GIFs from the 1990s. And it just says this website's under construction. And then it gives you all those. And I was contacted by the Museum of the Moving Image, who want to use it for their 140-foot projection screen that they have in one of their hallways for whenever they don't have an exhibit up. So I'm helping them put it up. And it's going to be this weird little historical thing that's got value. There are artists right now who are funded. This drives me nuts that this exists, but I've got artists who are in contact with me. One of them are flying me out in a month, who are doing nothing but studying GeoCities to show where we've come. Like, treatises on borders in web pages, you know, which is gone, you know, obviously we don't really have borders anymore, or the use of MIDI as background music. We've moved away from that, but why did people feel they need to do that? Anyway, it's been very inspiring. Anyway, thank you. Thank you for the compliment. And I guess that's all the questions. And or do you have one or a comment? You can have a question. You should have a question or a comment or a threat. All work.
I'll start by saying I was going to invest in your business, but I've changed my mind now.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, no, we've delayed the IPO indefinitely.
Yeah. But on the file formats you mentioned, it's unfortunate it's in the interest of a lot of companies to stop you from exporting
yes.
your content into another format.
In a short, cramped, foolish style, perhaps, yes.
Correct. I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
So I would say we should try and use, where possible, use open formats. Do not use proprietary formats.
I like open formats. For me, just understanding, given enough time, all formats are going to be open. The thing is that I think that there's a great advantage to pool, like, I'm working on, if it sounds like I work on a lot of different things, I do. But one of the projects I'm working on is to port a major emulator to JavaScript. And the reason I'm working on that is because I think that the next range in computer history, and you're allowed to not really care about computer history like I do, but I think the future is to embed an early computing experience in a window in the same way that we embed movies and music. Like, someone's like, and this band did this, here's the music. Or, yeah, we all went out today, here's the video. You should be able to say, man, people used to use VisiCalc, here's VisiCalc. Right? You should be able to, like, try it and understand, like, put up a page of, like, here's a bunch of word processors through the 80s, and you can see how they changed their features. Well, to do that, you need to run an emulator. But instead of, there's been a lot of effort to write emulators in JavaScript, but I have said, we shouldn't write an emulator. We should port a currently massive emulator to JavaScript and let the emulator people be the emulator people. And let the people who are doing all of the research into the emulator stuff work here. And all we're doing is this little piece. And I feel like it's that way with formats. That too many times people look at formats as, we have to have our own format. Because if we don't, now something is outside of our control. And it's so much easier to have everyone agree to at least use this format, even if they break it a little bit. Because even then, you know, even a broken format is a little helpful. You know, if it's like, well, 15 of the fields are right, and then these people, I don't know, the 16th field, they don't know what they're doing. That's great. That's 15 16ths of it. It's pretty good. It's not a venal sin. And so for me, I don't know, when I think of it, there seems to have been, like, open formatting has become, or open has become kind of a bad word that means charity. And I don't think it is. I think it's a good process in certain, I understand the need for a business case, but I just feel like in formats, if your business is so, it's like you run a hotel, but you're so scared that you lock all the doors so the guests can never leave, because you're afraid they're going to go to the other hotels? I don't know. I think that's a very long, very short-term way of thinking. I think that's it. Like I said, I'll be around all day, and I'll probably be here tonight. Thanks a lot.